الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى today we're going to speak about the biography of الإمام ابن القيم الجوزية رحمه الله. Many scholars have written about his life. The best scholar I came across who wrote the biography of Ibn al-Qayyim is Al-Allama Bakr ibn Abdullah Abu Zayd. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, he compiled the biggest book on the biography of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, his name is Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr ibn Ayyub ibn Sa'ad ibn Hariz. His laqab, his nickname, is Shamsuddin. And his kunya is Abu Abdullah. Ibn al-Qayyim had two sons. He had one son called Abdullah. And the second son that he had, his name is Ibrahim. And both of his sons, Ibrahim and Abdullah, both studied the religion and they became grounded in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even that though, Ibrahim, he was well known for learning the Arabic language. And he mastered the language. Ibrahim. And Abdullah, he was known for learning the other sciences of the religion. Both of his sons, they took from their father. So his kunya is named after his oldest son, Abdullah. So that's why his kunya is Abu Abdullah. He is Zura'iyul Asr. He's from the place Zura' originally. And then he's from Damascus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring Damascus safe and destroy the individual, the tyrant leader right now, or the regime. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah has the ability to do so. He is also a Hanbali. He's of the Hanbali madhab. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. But he's very well known as Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah is what he's known as. The scholars, they all unanimously agreed upon that Ibn al-Qayyim was born the year 691 and that he died the year 751. So Ibn al-Qayyim only lived for 60 years. Ibn al-Qayyim, the time that he was born, a year before it, was the year that took place between the battle between the Mamalik and the Tatar. So it was politically at that time, the battles of the Muslims with the non-believers, even the Crusades, the Salibiyin, a year before Ibn al-Qayyim's birth, they were managed to be taken out of Sham. So the wada, the situation of the Muslims at that time politically was a struggle. But finally, Ghazan got destroyed. The hands of Sham came back to the Muslims. And the leaders of the Muslim world had an agreement with the Tatar that they don't fight. Sham was not like Egypt. Egypt was more stable. Sham was very unstable. And after that, subhanAllah, the leaders of the Mamalik, the Muslim leaders, they started to kill each other, assassinate each other. And the fitan that started was well known. That's what politically, in summary, took place at the time, or was taking place at the time of Ibn al-Qayyim. As for the time, knowledge and ilm was very high. The caliber of knowledge was very high. There were great noble scholars at that time. Such as Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah was there. Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi rahimahullah, Sharafuddin al-Dimyati rahimahullah, Ibn Kathir, Ibn Abdul Hadi, Safadi, the author of Lisan al-Arab, Ibn al-Mandur. There was an era of knowledge. The great scholars were at that time, and that century, and that era. So ilm was of high caliber. So a person at that time to come out, to be known as a scholar and a person of knowledge, they would have to really be a person of knowledge. The reason is because the scholars who were there were already, I mean, they were scholars at that time. So a person who doesn't know cannot be known. Or a person who doesn't know anything about the deen. But when ignorance prevails, and ignorance is the greatest thing, and every individual can become a what? A sheikh. Everyone can be a alim, a scholar. It becomes a very loose title. Ibn Rajab, at the age of 20, Ibn al-Qayyim, at the age of 20, he met Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. And when he met him, he was fascinated with what he saw from this man. What he saw from him was the quwwatul hifdh. And we spoke about Ibn Taymiyyah previously before. So he took from him. He also took knowledge from Ibn Abdi Da'im al-Maqdisi rahimahullah. And Abul Hassan al-Kandi. He took knowledge from Isa al-Muta'im rahimahullah al-Maqdisi, Baha ibn Asakir. He also took from Al-Badr ibn Jama'ah. He took from Abu Abdullah al-Dhahabi. He also took hadith from Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi. He also took from Abi al-Fath al-Ba'laki, Safadiyya al-Hindi rahimahullah, Ibn Sayyid al-Nas al-Zamlakani, Ibn Muflih. He also took from a female scholar whose name was Fatima binti Jawharin al-Tabahi rahimahullah. So Ibn al-Qayyim took knowledge from great scholars of his time. His teachers, they passed 300 who he sat with, who he took knowledge from. And his students, in which he took knowledge from, are Al-Hafidh ibn Rajab al-Hanbali. Ibn Rajab praised him by saying that he took knowledge from him. He said, أخذ عنه العلم. Knowledge was sought from Ibn Qayyim by خلق كثير, many people. من حياة شيخه. Many people took knowledge from Ibn Qayyim. And he said, until he died, many people were coming to him. They were taking knowledge from him. وانتفعوا به, they benefited from him. وكان الفضلاء, the noble people, يعظمونه, they would honor Ibn Rajab, Ibn al-Qayyim. They would honor him. ويتتلمذون له. From the famous students that he had is, of course, I told you before, his son Ibrahim and his son Abdullah. Also, Hafidh ibn Kathir. Ibn Kathir took knowledge from Ibn al-Qayyim. As-Safadi, Khalil ibn Abik. Ibn Rajab. Subki, Ali ibn Abdul Kafi. He took knowledge from Ibn al-Qayyim. Ibn Abdul Hadi took knowledge, the author of the Kitab al-Sarim al-Munki fi al-Radd al-Subki. The author of the Qamus, Fayruza Abadi. He was a student of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. Ibn al-Qayyim, his life can be categorized into three. The first of that is Ibn al-Qayyim, his position towards the non-believers and the disbelievers. He had majal with them, he had a discussion with them. Had niqashat and debates. Rahimahullah. He also authored works in refutation of them. He has a book called, Rahimahullah, in refutation of the disbelievers, Hidayatul Hayara. In which he refutes the Christians and the Jews. Ibn al-Qayyim has an upper hand over Ibn Taymiyyah in authorship. The way Ibn al-Qayyim writes is far better than the way Ibn Taymiyyah wrote. Lian Ibn Taymiyyah was a person who would bring everything that just came to his mind and he wouldn't organize it. He would say it as he wishes. But Ibn al-Qayyim would sit down to author his works with the intention that the people can benefit from it, with the intention that writing it in a systematic way. Whereas Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Taymiyyah had information, his book is so much information overload. And if a person wants to read it, they'll see he goes sometimes 7, 10, 11 pages sometimes. Ibn Taymiyyah will go off topic. And he'll talk about something else. And you would actually forget what the book was about. Because of his knowledge and how vast it was. Ibn Taymiyyah will go everywhere. Whereas Ibn al-Qayyim will stick to the topic and what he wants to speak about. ولذلك ابن رجب ابن حجر العسقلاني he praised him in his Durr al-Kamina. He praised him in his the way he authors and the way he writes. The second way in which Ibn Qayyim is observed is his position with those who oppose the Sunnah. The Jahmiyyah, for example, that negate Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, his names and they negate Allah's names and attributes. ولذلك, when it comes to Allah's names, the groups are three. A group that negate Allah's name and attributes. And those are the Jahmiyyah. And a group that only negate Allah's characteristics, they affirm the names. And those are the Mu'tazila. The Mu'tazila affirm the name. But they don't believe there are meaning that are taken from Allah's names. Because Ahlul Sunnah's Qa'idah is Allah's names are أعلام باعتبار دلالتها على الذات وأوصاف باعتبار دلالتها على المعاني. أهل السنة believe all the 99 names of Allah, they have meaning inside it. الرحمن صفة الرحمة. الرحمن is merciful. That's the second group. So the Jahmiyyah, they don't believe the name, nor do they believe the characteristics. Whereas Mu'tazila believe the names and they don't believe the characteristics that are taken out of the names. And the third group are the Asha'ira. They believe the name and they only believe seven characteristics. So that's why the scholars, they say that the Asha'ira are the closest to Ahl Sunnah, because at least they affirm what? Characteristics. Ala kulli hal, Ibn al-Qayyim, he has a kitab which he wrote against those three tawa'if, those three groups of people. The Jahmiyyah and the Mu'tazila and the Asha'ira, which he called it Ijtima'u Juyush al-Islamiyyah, which he refuted them in. The third type in which Ibn al-Qayyim can be categorized into is that Ibn al-Qayyim was a person who dealt with the heart. And he's a man who gave so much importance to the qulub and the hearts and the cures of the heart. The heart goes through illnesses, right? And Ibn al-Qayyim summarized the illness of the heart into two. He said that the illness of the heart are two. What are they? Marad al-Shubha and Marad al-Shahwa. The illness of doubt. People doubting their religion, doubting. So he deals with that. And the second type of illness is what? Marad al-Shahwa, which is desires. And he categorized the heart into three. A qalb, which is marid, a sick heart. That sick heart though, it has sparks of good in it. The person's fighting. Sometimes they fall, but they grab themselves again and they get up and they work hard and they push themselves. He called it qalb, which is marid. And then the second type of heart, he said, a qalb which is mayyit, dead. And he says, this is the heart of the disbeliever. And he brings the ayat, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَيْتًا, the one who is dead. The nusus that talk about the dead one. Meaning the disbeliever's heart is dead. And the third one is qalb which is salim. Qalb which is salim means a heart which is pure heart. And that is the one Allah accepts the Day of Judgment. As he said in the Quran, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. That is the heart which Allah accepts. So Ibn al-Qayyim, he took those three majal, those three paths in his works and his life. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. Then a person who wants to be of Ibn al-Qayyim's way, then needs to know that is what it is. It's not that a person just takes one part of Ibn al-Qayyim's life. This is a whole madrasa. Rahimahullah. ولذلك, his he had more connection to the heart and the speech of the heart than his own teacher Ibn Taymiyyah. He explained one of the greatest books in this regard, the Kitab Madarij al-Salikin. بَيْنَ مَنَازِلِ إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. This book, all it talks about is the ayah إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. If you take the Taba'a of Dar al-Tayyibah, which is six volumes, it talks about the stations of إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Asl of the Kitab is called مَنَازِلُ السَّائِرِينَ, and it's written by Shaykh al-Islam Abu Ismail al-Harawi rahimahullah. And Ibn al-Qayyim took that book and he explains that book. What does he do? He explains that book. And the author of that book, Abu Ismail al-Harawi, is a Sufi. But Ibn al-Qayyim takes that book and he explains it. Wherever he agrees with him. Wherever he disagrees with him. He also wrote a book called another book called Ighathatul Lahfan fi Masayid al-Shaytan. This book of his is again a book. He starts off first of all speaking about what? Speaking about the types of heart there are. The types of heart there are. And he, rahimahullah, he gave a lot of importance to the early stages of his life, a lot of authorship, as we're going to see. But at the end of his life, he spent as zuhd. He was very aesthetic. He just cut off the world. He walked away from everything. And he used to stay in the masjid. Some of the historians, they mentioned that he spent the rest of his life, the later stages of his life, he spent it in cleaning the masjid, being inside the masjid, and serving the people inside the masjid. Rahimahullah. He used to go to Hajj. And when he would go to Hajj, he would say to the people, he would cover his face. People would know it's him. And he would take things for people, carry things for people. He would give them money, what he had for his money that he had for the Hajj, that he would prepare an amount in which he would give to the people. Rahimahullah. When somebody would come to him, he would say to, is anybody with you? If they say no, he said, can you see anyone around? If they say no, he would give them money. If somebody else was around, he wouldn't give them money. He would say to him, come to me at a time when we're alone. And he loved to hide his righteous deeds. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. He also has a book called Ahkamu Ahli Dhimma, where he talks about the rulings of the disbelievers who are from the Ahlul Dhimma. There's a book he wrote, and it's the greatest book Ibn al-Qayyim ever wrote. Shaykh Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz alayhi rahmatullahi, he said about this book, he said it is the book of Islam. Ibn Baz said this. And it's none other than his book, I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in. His kitab, I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in, al-Rabbi al-Alameen. This book, Ibn al-Qayyim, talks about many matters pertaining to usul al-fiqh, qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, and how to extract rulings from the Qur'an and the Sunnah. This book, it's a summary of all of the books written in this field. This is it. Rahimahullah, 67 volumes he authored. He also wrote a book which he called Tuhfatul Mawlud bi Ahkamil Mawlud, where he speaks about a newborn baby. What are the ahkam to take? What are the rulings and the things that need to be done for that newborn baby? He, rahimahullah, authored a book called Jala'u al-Afham fi Fadli al-Salati ala Khayri al-Anam, where in this book of his, he talks about the virtue and the rulings pertaining to the Salat on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, sending salutation on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibn al-Qayyim wrote a book on that. And he brings that the Sahabas and the narrations that have come regarding the Salah of the Prophet are 34. He brings all the Sahabas that narrated it, and the Turuq, and the different wordings. And then he talks about the meaning of what the word Salah means. Does the word actually Salah mean Ar-Rahmah, or is it different from Rahmah? Some of the scholars, they said it's the same, right? Ibn al-Qayyim says, no, they're two different things. How are they different? Because Allah said in the Quran, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ. And he said, the fact that Allah distinguished between the two, in the Arabic language, grammar, they say, وَالْوَاوُ فِي أَصْلِ اللُّغَةِ تَقْتَضِ الْمُغَايَرَةِ. The waw in the original usage of the language, it shows that the two things are different. That they don't mean the same, صح? Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يَحْمِلُونَ الْعَرْشَ وَمَنْ حَوْلَهُ. The angels that are carrying the throne and the angels that are around the throne, are they the same angels? Yeah. Are they two different angels?
There's angels, there's eight of them, is it? The ones who carry the crown.
So the ones that are carrying Allah's throne and the ones who are around it, are they the same angels?
No.
Or are they two different angels?
Two different.
How do we know it's two different angels?
The
wow that's in there.
Is the eight of them, the greatest angels, like...
Na'am, the ones that are carrying the throne are different from the ones who are not. The evidence for that is the waw. We just learned that the waw, in the language, it shows that they're two different things. So Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah emphasizes and pushes that the ayah, salah, it means something different from rahmah. And that the salah means thana'ullahi, Allah praising the Prophet ﷺ fi mala'il a'la, high above. Allah is praising the Prophet up. That's what it means. And he took the qawl of Abu Aliyah, which Al-Imam al-Bukhari brought it, fi sahihihi mu'allaqan. That Al-Imam al-Bukhari brought it in his sahih without a chain. That Abu Aliyah al-Rayahi, student of Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and Abdullah ibn Umar, said that the word salah means, on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it means thana'ullahi, Allah praising the Prophet high above. So it doesn't mean al-Rahmah. So he wrote a book on this issue and he deals with it. He also has a kitab called Al-Jawab al-Sahih, Al-Jawab al-Kafi liman sa'ala 'an ad-dawa' al-Shafi, which is also known as Ad-Da' wa-Dawa'. This book is a book, I think this particular time, has it been translated in the English language? I've seen portions of it. But I don't know if it's all been translated, where he talks about the illnesses of sins and its cures. He talks about sins, that's the da', and the dawa, which is the cure of these sins, how to cure yourself from it. So what he starts his book with, the book was, it's a question that's put to him. Somebody sends him a question, they say to him, Shaykh al-Islam ibn al-Qayyim rahimakallah, I'm a person, I've repented. I've asked Allah for forgiveness. I know I'm upon sins. I always repent and I'm coming back to it again. And I'm coming back to it again. And there's no way out of it for me. I want you to give me a response. So the book was called Al-Jawab al-Kafi, the sufficing response. Liman sa'ala, the one who asked, Ani Dawa'i Shafi, who asked for the effective cure, which is also known as Ad-Da' wa-Dawa. And Ibn al-Qayyim straight away starts by talking about that Allah does not send down an illness except He sends with it a cure. Sins is a what? It's a marad, it's an illness. And it's impossible that Allah sends down an illness except He sends it with a? He has to send it with a cure. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he talks about, straight after that, he talks about the things that that are cure for the sins. And he starts by mentioning ad-du'a. But then he goes into speaking about there are things that can prevent a person from their du'a being accepted. And he mentions the famous hadith that al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated in hadith Abi Huraira, ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ الرَّجُلَ يُطِيلُ السَّفَرَ أَشْعَثَ أَغْبَرَ يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ يَا رَبْ يَا رَبْ وَمَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامٌ وَمَلْبَسُهُ حَرَامٌ وَغُذِيَ بِالْحَرَامِ وَمَشْرَبُهُ حَرَامٌ وَغُذِيَ بِالْحَرَامِ فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لِذَلِكَ. He brings that hadith, the man who, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ بِمَا أَمَرَ بِهِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is tayyib, and He only accepts that which is good. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what Allah commanded the believers is what He commanded the messengers and the prophets. And then He tells us that Allah commanded us to what? It brings two ayat. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَاعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا. يَا أَيُّهَا الرُّسُلُ كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. In those two ayah, Allah tells us that the believers and the messengers were commanded two things: أَكْلُوا الطَّيِّبَاتِ, eating good, and الْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ, صح? Come with righteous actions. رحمه الله. And he mentions in there that story of a man who traveled. This man came with four things that his dua should have been accepted. And he, for his dua to be accepted, which are called muqtadayatul ijaba. And he also came with four things that prevented his dua to not be accepted, which are called mawani'ul ijaba. And this in balagha is called, this type of eloquency that the Prophet used right now, which is four reasons for them to accept and four to not be accepted. Muqabalatul kalam, muqabalatul bayan, which is that you mention something and you mention the exact opposite in the same amount. This is the form of eloquency that the Prophet used. This man, he is a what? He's a traveler. Italatul safar is one of the reasons why your dua should be accepted. The Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that the traveler, his dua is accepted, right? Number two. The second thing that this man's dua should be accepted is يَمُدُّ يَدَهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ. He put his hand up in the sky. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيِّيٌّ كَرِيمٌ. Allah is shy and Allah is generous. إِذَا رَفَعَ إِلَيْهِ عَبْدٌ يَدَاءٌ. No slave raised his hands up for Allah except Allah gives him what he wants. That's how Allah is. No one puts his hand up. So the second reason why this man's dua should have been accepted, it was that he raised his hand. The third thing that the man came with was يُطِيلُ السَّفَرَ أَشْعَثَ أَغْبَرَ يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ يَا رَبْ. The man kept saying Ya Rab. The man said the word Ya Rab. And if you look at Surah Ali Imran, Allah tells us الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. That the believers, they know Allah did not create all of this falsely. They look at it, they ponder over it, and they contemplate. And then look what Allah says to us after that. What does Allah tell us? They keep saying, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Ya Rab. And the last page, what does the ayah start with? فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ. Allah accepted their dua. And then the usage of the word Ya Rab, it's taken from that ayah that it's one of the reasons a dua is accepted. And a fourth thing that this man came with was he was repeating the request from Allah. When he was asking Allah, he was asking him excessively. Are we all together? Al-ilhahu fi dua. That he was begging him and he wasn't letting go. Those are the four reasons why his dua should be accepted, right? Each one independently can make his dua be accepted. But then he came with four opposite things that make his dua not accepted. What is it, brothers? مطعمه حرام. This man, he's eating is haram. ملبسه حرام. His clothing that he's wearing is haram. مشربه حرام. What he drinks is haram. وغذي بالحرام. He was nurtured upon haram. And then the word غذي is different from مطعمه. It's more generic. غذي, it means things that it doesn't mean eating. غذاء is different from طعام. How is it different? نوم is غذاء. دواء is غذاء. Sleeping is a ghada. And medication is ghada. So it's not necessarily the same when you hear the word ghada and you hear the word ta'am. Are we all together? So Al-Allama Ibn Al-Qayyim, he based on this book. Those are the four reasons he mentions in which these people's dua wasn't accepted. So he says that when we supplicate to Allah and we say, Oh Allah, take us away, get this sin away from me, it's not being accepted because of this. And then he speaks about the dangers of sins. And he talks about how Allah punishes nations based on sins. It's a book, I ask you brothers, if you don't learn the Arabic language, except for that book, it deserves it. It's really a book that will help you a lot. He also, rahimahullah, he wrote a book called Hadi al-Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah, where he talks about the description of Jannah. This book is a description of Jannah. Was Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, was he in Jannatul Khuld? Was Adam in the Jannah that we know today? Or was he in another Jannah? When Allah told Adam to leave Jannah, is it the Jannah which Allah said, the Prophet said in Hadith Anas ibn Malik, مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. That Jannah is a place where eyes have never seen, ears have never heard of, and it has never come to the heart of any person. Is it this one that he was taken out of, Adam, huh? Or was it another Jannah? It was another Jannah, huh?
The dalil for that is because Shaitan, Allah casted out Shaitan. So if Shaitan was casted out of Jannah, how could he give us waswas?
How can he give us waswas? Buy this book, Hadi al-Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah, read it. Ibn al-Qayyim, he discusses this issue. And he talks about it in details. And he talks about Jannah and how it looks. And the inhabitants of Jannah. And the people of Jannah. This is what he talks about in this book. Brothers, his books are gold. Wallahi, Ibn al-Qayyim's works are amazing. He has another kitab called Risala. Risala Ibn al-Qayyim ila Ahadi Ikhwanihi. It's a book Ibn al-Qayyim wrote a message to one of his brothers. Not his brother's blood brothers, but a Muslim brother of his who asked him something. And Ibn al-Qayyim tells him a powerful advice in this book. He tells him, do you want to attain leadership in this world? Leadership doesn't necessarily mean you're in charge of people. But do you want to be ahead of everything? Do you want to be noble? Do you want to reach somewhere? He says that this is based on following the ayah of the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةِ يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُ وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُقِنُونَ. And he brings the qa'ida, which is بِالصَّبْرِ وَالْيَقِينِ تُنَالُ الْإِمَامَةَ فِي الدِّينِ. With yaqeen and sabr, a person will reach leadership. When you're a person who has patience, and when you're a person who has yaqeen, certainty, you will reach leadership. So he bases the risala on that, and he goes in. He also has a book called Ar-Ruh. Ibn al-Qayyim has a book called Ar-Ruh. He talks about the soul. And he talks about the difference between Ar-Ruh and An-Nafs. Does anyone know the difference between Ruh and Nafs? Yeah?
Ar-Ruh
min Amr Rabbi.
An-Nafs.
Hey, Fadl Abdul Latif.
The soul, once it's created, it will always live. The nafs will come to an end with
more. Hmm. Now, The ruh is when it's independent from the body. The ruh, when it's independent, it stands by itself. And the nafs is when it's part, when it's inside the body. Yeah. And he brings shawahid and examples for that, Ibn al-Qayyim, and he deals with that issue. وَلِذَلِكَ one of the mistakes that Shaykh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani fell into was that he thought that this book Ibn al-Qayyim wrote it in his early stages. Because there are some things in there that Ibn al-Qayyim says that is very awkward. So Shaykh Nasir rahimahullah thought that this was Ibn al-Qayyim's early works, and that's why he did these mistakes. That's not the case. Why? Because he references Ibn Taymiyyah in there. Okay? So, it's a kitab that he wrote, and it deserves to be bought. Now, no doubt. He has a book called Zad al-Mi'ad fi Hadi Khayr al-Ibad. Recently got published by Dar al-Alim al-Fawaid. They published it with, mashallah, with many manuscripts. And they've worked very good on it. Before, we used to have the tahqiq of Sheikh Shu'aib Arnaud, Mu'assasat al-Risala. And now, this one, Dar al-Alim al-Fawaid, they brought the best copy out. So it just reached the Ma'arad, the book fair this year. This book, he talks about the Prophet's biography. And it's Zadul Bi'ad that the book At-Tibun Nabawi was taken out of. Have you heard of the Prophet's medicine? That's not a book he wrote separately. It's taken out of the Zadul Mi'ad. Because remember, he talks about the Prophet's life, right? So he talks about the Prophet's medicine as well, what medicines he used to take. So it's taken out of there. And they made it separately into what we today, the, when we say Tibb al-Nabawi, prophetic medicine. Who's read that book? I've seen it. Have you all seen that book, the prophetic medicine? rahimahullah. He has another book called Shifa'ul Alil. He called it Shifa'ul Alil fi masail al-qadr fi masail al-qada'i wal-qadr wal-hikmah wat-ta'lil. This book of his, he talks about this issue of the qada and the qadr. What's the difference between qadr and qada? What's the difference between qadr and qada? What's the difference? He talks about it there. He also talks about Allah's actions. Do they have wisdom in it? He also talks about why would Allah punish us if He knows we're going to go to the hellfire? These things that today some people think it's a new shubha, a new doubt that's been brought up, that's been clothed differently, it's been quite, all of them, la shakka wa la rayb, our ulama before have already spoken about it. He wrote a book on that. He also has a book called Turuq al-Hukmiya fi Siyasati al-Shar'iyya, where he talks about Islamic politics. He talks about the things that are required for the Muslim leader, the do's and the don'ts. He talks about what is needed from the people who follow who are under the leader, the do's and the don'ts. He speaks about it. He has another book called Iddatu Sabirin wa Dakhiratu Shakirin. It's also called Iddatu Sabirin wa Dakhiratu Shakirin, where he talks about the two wings that a bird needs to fly. A bird, can it fly with one wing? What does it fly with? Two wings. He says that the person who wants to go to Allah, who wants to reach Allah, he has to have these two wings, patience and gratitude. And then he speaks about those two, that you have to be a person who's patient. Because your situation, brothers and sisters, is that you're either struggling in life, so you need to come with patience. Or you're going through good and ease, you need to come with gratitude. The hadith of the Sahabi, Abu Hadith al-Suhaib, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, عجب لأمر المؤمن. Amazement and fascination and wonder is in the affairs of the believers. In amrahu kullahu khayr. All of his affairs are good. In asabatu barra. If hardship or calamities befall him, sabara. فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتُ صَرَّاءُ. And if he's at times of good and ease, شَكَرَ, he shows gratitude. And then he goes and say in the Prophet, وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. This is only for the believer. Look at your life today. You're either struggling or you're going through hardship, or you're going through what? Ease, joy. Both times, there's a type of ibadah that's required from you. You're a slave. The type of ibadah that's needed from you at times of ease is what? Shukr. At times of hardship, the ibadah that's needed from you is what? Sabr. He wrote a book on that. Question now. In this book, Ibn al-Qayyim tackles a very powerful topic that people generally must have heard this question before. Which one is greater in the eyes of Allah? A. Patient, poor patient person, or a rich person who has gratitude? Which one does Allah love more? I mean, which one is greater? A person who's rich, but who comes with shukr, gratitude. Or a person who's poor, but is patient. Is the question clear? Which one is better? A faqir who's sabir, or a ghari who's shakir? Huh? The ghani is better. Better than the poor who shows patience.
He mentioned that the poverty that Allah was sees all the poverty in money, mm-hmm. but the poverty that in the hearts, you know, in similitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's the one created in that book.
So it's nothing to do with the money.
Yes, yeah, to do with the poverty and gratitude that you have in your heart. That's what Allah loves to see.
Naam, he brings that up. He mentions that in his kitab, Iddatu Sabir. You read it in Arabic?
It's got published in English.
It's published in English, huh? Is it all of it, Akin?
It's the whole of it, yeah. 25 chapters.
Naam. So Ibn al-Qayyim deals with it in that book. Buy it. Buy that book, and inshaAllah ta'ala, all of his works, by the way, all of his works, the overwhelming majority of his works, they have been published by Dar Alim al-Fawaid. Okay, the reason I'm telling you these things is so you can go more. It's not for you to just hear this and say, wow, Allahum barik, mashallah, he said that, and just leave it there. No, I want you to go and research and get to the bottom of that question. I wonder what he said. And even try to learn the Arabic language for that reason. He also wrote a book called Al-Furusiyyah Al-Muhammadiyyah, where Ibn Qayyim talks about jihad and how the Muslims prepare their army and how learning archery, and he talks about matters pertaining to that, rahimahullah. And he mentions at the ending of the book, his Kitab Furusiyyah Al-Muhammadiyyah, at the ending, he talks about Asbabun Nusra in jihad, how Allah can give victory to the Muslims. And he mentions the shurut, the conditions. And he brings the ayah, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu attaqullah, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasulah wa awli al-amri minkum. La la, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. What's the last ayah, Sheikh Jamal? Qawlu before, Wa la tanaza'u fatafshal wa tadhhab rihukum wasbiru inna Allah ma'as sabirin. Before that, Ya ayyuhal ladhina wa ati'u Allah wa Rasulah. فإن تنازع وأطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول فإن تنازعتم
في شيء
إذا تنازعتم في شيء ها فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا. And he brings those ayat together, Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah. And what he does is that he mentions the shurut, the conditions of a nasr in that book, and how Allah gives victory to the people. He has a book called Al-Fawa'id, where he gathered in that book is just benefits. Just benefits. That came to his head, he wrote it. It's called Fawa'id. It's different from his six-volume book called, a five-volume book called Al-Fawa'id, the Bada'i Al-Fawa'id. Bada'i Al-Fawa'id is another one. It's another one, just one page. And it's called Al-Fawa'id. He has a 5,000 line poetry. 5,000 lines of poetry called Al-Kafiyatu Al-Shafiyah, الانتصار للفرقة الناجية, which is known as a Nuniyyah ibn al-Qayyim, which is known as what? The Nuniyyah ibn al-Qayyim. But it's origin, what's the real name for it? Al-Kafiyyah al-Shafiyyah للانتصار للفرقة الناجية, where he talks about so many things. 5,000 lines, rahimahullah. He has a book called Kitab al-Salah wa hukmu tarikuha, wa hukmu tarikuha. He talks about the Salah and the ruling of the one who leaves it. He wrote a book on that. He has a book called Miftahu Dari Sa'ada, where he talks about knowledge. He talks about knowledge and having a drive. And he says that anybody who wants to really get to the bottom of something, they have to have those two. If I know how to make something, but I don't have the drive, will I ever do it? If I know how to do something, I have the knowledge for it, but I don't have the drive, I don't want to do it, will I ever go about doing it? No. What about if I want to do something, but I don't have the knowledge for it? Will I ever be able to do it? So he said, anything that wants to be achieved and done, he said it requires what? He said, himmatun turaqih wa ilmun yubassiruhu wa yahdi. He said it requires what? It requires knowledge and having insight. And it also requires a drive and a willpower that the person has. Also, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he wrote a kitab called Al-Wabil al-Sayyib. This book, Al-Wabil al-Sayyib, some people thought that was an explanation on the kitab Al-Kalim al-Tayyib written by Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. They think that it is. That's not the case. It's called, the book is called Al-Wabil al-Sayyib min Al-Kalim al-Tayyib. This is his own work. And Badruddin al-Ayni rahimahullah, he has a sharh on the kitab of Ibn al-Qayyim, Al-Kalim al-Tayyib by Ibn Taymiyyah, sorry. Like, and this is different from it. He wrote a book where he speaks about the issue of dhikr and fawaid. Walidarik, at the beginning of this book, Al-Wabil al-Sayyib, he brings 100 benefits of the dhikr. When you want to remember Allah, the fawaid and the benefits that he holds. Rahimahullah. The scholars at his time, they praised Ibn al-Qayyim. Al-Qadi Burhanuddin Az-Zura'i, he said, ما تحت أديم السماء, there is no one below the sky, أوسع علما منه, that has more vast knowledge than Ibn al-Qayyim, his own teacher. Now pay attention, when a student praises a teacher, that's nothing. When a student praises the teacher, that's bound to happen, because the student doesn't know as much as the teacher, right? But what it really means something is when the teacher praises the student. Like Sheikh Jamal, his Sheikh Abdul Rashid praises him. If the teacher, if the student praises you, that's la qeemata lahu. Does it have any qeema? La qeemata lahu. Like, if the teacher looks at the student and praises the student for his understanding and his knowledge, this is a fadl ulama mentioned. Walidalika Ibn al-Qayyim, his teacher, Shaykh Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi praised him. Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi praised him. And he said to him, Ibn al-Qayyim, هو في هذا الزمان كابن خزيمة في زمانه. He said that Ibn al-Qayyim is like Ibn Khuzaymah, Imam al-A'imma, the author of the Sahih. He said Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim is the Ibn Khuzaymah of this time, of our era. That's a great praise. Hafid al-Dhahabi, who's the teacher of Ibn al-Qayyim, he said, al-faqih, al-imam, al-mufti, al-mutafannin, al-nahwi. He called him faqih, a jurist. Imam. Imam is what? Man yuqtada bihi, anyone who's followed in good. Al-mufti, he's a mufti. He's mutafannin. Mutafannin means what? A person who knows many sciences, who's mastered many sciences. And he said after that, an-nahwiyu, the grammarian. So it's very important that we take all of these points on board. And this is something very powerful. When this statement is being said, al-mutafannin, we need to know, brothers, that we have this nowadays, this idea has creeped into the Muslim community, which is, I want to become a person who only studies one science. That's not good. A Muslim should try to learn the religion, all of it. Na'am, Allah is going to always make you love one science over the rest, no doubt. Allah might open something for you. You might like hadith, you might like fiqh, you might like this or that after. But that doesn't mean you're ignorant about the other sciences. If discussions and knowledge is, if hadith is being spoken about, you're not ignorant, you know what's happening here. Sah? If fiqh comes up, you know what it is. If you speak hadith is being spoken, you know it. If tafsir, here, every science of the religion, you have a great, strong foundation on it. And then if you choose to go for one particular science, and you think this is what you love the most, then do it after that. But that doesn't mean you're ignorant about the rest. And you know nothing about it. That's how the Salaf were not like that. The ulama before were not like that. They would study all sciences and they would always be proficient and they would go further into one particular science. Also Salah As-Safadi rahimahullah, he said about Ibn al-Qayyim, he said, اشتغل كثيرا. He said he was very busy, Ibn al-Qayyim. وَنَاظَرَ. Brothers, pay attention to this. Look at Ibn al-Qayyim was very busy. A person is like that, ya ikhwa. He's busy with khair and good. Your whole life, everything about you, this is it. Give it to it. Ibn al-Qayyim was very busy in knowledge. If he wasn't teaching, he was writing. If he wasn't writing, he was reading. If he wasn't reading, he was praying. He was busy in khair and good. Ishtagala, he was busy. Kathiran so much. Wa nadhara, he debated. Wa ijtahada, he strove. Wa akabba ala talab. He's a person who stood over and done i'tikaf on seeking knowledge. وَصَنَّفَ, he authored. وَصَارَ مِنَ الْأَئِمَّةِ الْكِبَارِ, and he became from the greatest scholars. فِي عِلْمِ التَّفْسِيرِ وَالْحَدِيثِ وَالْأُصُولِ فِقْهًا وَكَلَامًا وَفُرُوعُ وَالْفُرُوعُ وَالْعَرَبِيَّةِ وَلَمْ يُخَلِّفِ الشَّيْخَ الْعَلَّامَةَ قِيُّدِّينِ بْنُ تَيْمِيَةَ مِثْلَهُ. He became an imam in tafsir and hadith and usul and fiqh, and he also became an imam in the sciences that were opposing him, that the other groups would speak. Ibn al-Qayyim would study it. He would learn it. Ilm al-Kalam and Ilm al-Jadal, he studied that. He also studied furu', such as fiqh. He studied Arabic language very well. And look what he said after that. وَلَمْ يُخَلِّفْ. Ibn Taymiyyah never left behind no one like Ibn al-Qayyim after him. Ibn Rajab said about him, الفقيه الأصولي المفسر النحوي العارف تفقه في المذهب وبرع وأفتى وتفنن في علوم الإسلام وكان عارفا بالتفسير لا يجارى فيه وبأصول الدين وإليه فيه من المنتهى والحديث ومعانيه وفقه ودقائق الاستنباط منه لا يلحق في ذلك وبالفقه وأصوله وبالعربية وله فيها اليد الطولى. He said about him, he's a faqih, he's a usuli, he's a mufassir, he's a nahwi, he's a arif. Arif is a term that's generally used for a person who's very aesthetic, who leaves his dunya, whose heart is towards the hereafter. Ulidarika, generally speaking, when it comes to this issue of seeking knowledge and learning, you can always tend to see from the imams and the scholars, they were always people who were aesthetic as well. And they were zuhad, And they were very humble people. Wallahi, you saw that. Whenever you read the tarjama of any alim, they were always people, when you read their biographies, you would see that from them. Arif, he was a zahid. The more they learned, the more they turned their eye away from the dunya. Every alim that you read about, the more they studied, the more they learned, the more they realized that they were nothing. May Allah give us the ikhlas and that heart. وَإِلَيْهِ فِيهِمَا الْمُنْتَهِ وَالْحَدِيثِ He learned hadith, its meaning, its fiqh, its hidden istimbatat. He learned it, rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn Rajab then said, وَلَا رَأَيْتُ أَوْسَعَ مِنْهُ عِلْمًا I never saw anyone more vast than him in knowledge. وَلَا أَعْرَفَ بِمَعَانِ الْقُرْآنَ وَالسُّنَّةِ I never saw anyone who knew the Qur'an and the Sunnah's meaning more than he did. وَحَقَائِقِ الْإِيمَانِ مِنْهُ وَلَيْسَ هُوَ بِالْمَعْصُومِ He's not infallible from mistakes. وَلَكِنْ لَمْ أَرَى فِي مَعْنَاهُ مِثْلَهُ No one like him did I see. He's not infallible. He can do mistakes. But I haven't seen anyone like him. Ibn Nasir al-Din al-Dimashqi, he said, أحد المحققين. A muhaqqiq is a person who reached a level that they can actually, they can give a views that are out there. He can choose one view from it. You know what Ibn Hajar said about Ibn al-Qayyim? He said, Ibn al-Qayyim, every issue, and it's true, if you look at his works, I like that. He will bring all of the views that are out there. Every view that's out there. And he will choose which one's right. And he will tell you why he believes this is right. This is ittila' wasi'i, ya ikhwah. This is a vast type of reading. That you can be all of the aqwal here right in front of you. And you mention each person what their evidences are. And each party what their view is. And then after that you can say he's right, he's wrong, he's right, this one's wrong, this one's right. The reason is because of this. Hakada. That's how Ibn al-Qayyim was, rahimahullah ta'ala. But ikhwah, this comes from a person who surrendered his affairs to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we're going to, inshaAllah ta'ala, stand over some of the powerful statements that Ibn al-Qayyim said about the most eloquent statements of his. Some of the eloquent statements of his, rahimahullah ta'ala. He said something powerful. He said, لا يجتمع الإخلاص في القلب. Sincerity will not combine in the heart of a person. Sincerity وَمَحَبَّةِ الْمَدْحِ وَالثَّنَاءِ And the love of people to praise you. Both of them can't be in your heart. For you to love the people to praise you, and the people to what? And to be sincere, they both can't come together. If you see that you love people praising you, you with me, brothers? Then that's not sincerity. Sincerity is missing. They both can't be together in the same place. And there are signs, brothers. There are signs when a person loves praise. Signs that a person loves praise is that when criticism hurts you more than praise. When the criticism hurts you more than the praise. You should more enjoy the criticism than you should enjoy the... Why, brothers? Because if you believed you were deficient and you weren't complete, if a person tells you a deficiency in you, they've only told you what you knew of yourself, that you were deficient in the first place. Are we together? This is the kalam of Ibn al-Qayyim, by the way. But if you get praised and it pleases you because you believed you were complete and you're complete, there's nothing wrong with you. The fact that the person is reassuring that for you, it brings joy to you. He said another very powerful statement. He said, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَن تَعْلَمَ If you want to know, مَا عِنْدَكَ وَعِنْدَ غَيْرِكَ مِنْ مَحَبَّةِ اللَّهِ If you want to know you and others, if Allah loves you, he said, فَانْظُرْ مَحَبَّةَ الْقُرْآنِ مِنْ قَلْبِكَ Look at the love of the Qur'an in your heart. If you want to know, somebody might come to you and say, how do I know Allah loves me? We'll say, how much do you love His word? The mahabba of the Qur'an and the love of the Qur'an, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, where it stands in your heart is where Allah stands in your heart. And that's how He is to you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mentioning of Allah, is it high to you? Yeah, brothers. Is the mentioning of Allah, His Qur'an, His words, they mean a lot to you? Then the mentioning of your name to Allah, it means a lot to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what he says, Ibn al-Qayyim. Are we all together? Brothers, it is not then right that you say as a person, I love the Qur'an, and you don't even try to memorize anything from it. The love cannot just be a mere statement. It can't be. The love has to manifest on your limbs. It has to then become actions. It has to be a movement forward. It has to be something you try to come with. And I've seen brothers, wallahi, when these kind of quotes they came across, wallahi, they took it serious. And they made the Qur'an their closest friend. Not to mention, round the corner is Ramadan. And some people made an oath with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُ اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. The believers, when they make a promise, they stick by their promise, right? Some people made promises last Ramadan, that when next Ramadan comes, and I pray behind the Imam in the Taraweeh, I promise I'm going to learn the Quran. Huh? That's what they said. And I'm going to understand what he's trying to say. And I'm going to learn a great portion of the Quran. Here's the next Ramadan, it's round the corner. It's round the corner. And then, the love that you have for the Quran is an indication of the love of Allah for you. That's a reality. He said, al-bakhilu faqirun. He said, the one who's stingy is poor. La yu'jaru ala faqrihi. And he's not going to be rewarded for his poverty. The one who's stingy, who doesn't want to give, he's actually poor. He's what? He's poor. And he will not be what? And he will not be rewarded for his poverty. Because the other one who's poor, what would he do? Who's actually poor? Allah rewards you for your poorness because you're patient upon it. Like this one, he's stingy, he's got the money, but he's really poor. How is he poor? Because all that he can see is that he's not going to have anything after this. If he gives it out, he shakes. He thinks, oh, I don't know what I'm going to tomorrow, I'm going to eat. Faqr has been placed right in front of his eyes. So he's actually poor, he said, this one. And guess what? He gets no reward for this. He gets no reward for it. He also said, Rahimahullah, he said, "Man ashaqa dunya," anyone who loves this dunya and gives his heart to it, and he's in love with this dunya, the dunya will take that person and it will use you as a slave. The dunya will take you as a slave and humiliate you. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا, and anyone who turns away from it, then the dunya will respect you and come to you as a slave. And this is the truth. The Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? Anybody who turns away from the dunya, صح? مَنْ جَعَلَ الدُّنْيَا أَكْبَرَ هَمِّهِ, anyone who makes the dunya, his ultimate goal. What did the Prophet say? جَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْفَقْرَ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ. Allah places poverty right in front of his eyes. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala disperses all of his everything from him. وَشَتَّتَ اللَّهُ شَمْلَهُ. The strength and his ability, Allah will take it away from him. But the person who makes the akhirah, and he makes the akhirah his ultimate goal, أَتَتْهُ الدُّنْيَا وَهِيَ رَاغِبَةً, the dunya will come in need of you, begging you, asking you, and you're turning away from it. Like as Allah said in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَ لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُ مَشْكُورًا كُلًّا نُمِدُّ هَؤُلَاءِ وَهَؤُلَاءِ مِنْ عَطَاءِ رَبِّكَ وَمَا كَانَ عَطَاءُ رَبِّكَ مَحْظُورًا. This is a person who made the akhirah their ultimate goal. Every single alim that achieved something, if you look at them, their heart was not for the dunya, and it was for the akhirah. He said something powerful as well. He said, "Walil abdi siturun baynahu wa bayna Allah." The slave has a veil between him and Allah. There's a veil placed between him and Allah. Ibn Qayyim said that there is a veil between Allah and the slave. Wa siturun baynahu wa bayna nas, and that there's a veil between, and there's a veil between you and the people. فَمَنْ هَتَكَ السِّتْرَ الَّذِي بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ, anybody who moves away the veil between him and Allah, هَتَكَ اللَّهُ السِّتْرَ الَّذِي بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ النَّاسِ, Allah will move the veil that's between you and the people. There's a veil between you and Allah. If you move that veil, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will move the one between you and the people. The people see everything about you. وَلِذَلِكَ Umar radiallahu anhu, a man came up to him And then he stole, and he was brought to Umar. And when he stole and he was brought to Umar, the man cried. He said, I'm sorry, I never did this before, I won't do it again. Umar said, you're a liar. Kadhab. Allah does not expose his slave on the first attempt. Allah never exposes you on the first time. You did this many times to be caught now. وَهَذَا سُنَنُ اللَّهِ. That's the way Allah is, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn al-Qayyim, after he finished 60 years of in this world, he died, rahimahullah ta'ala. He died on a Thursday when the year was 751. And he died when the adhan of Salatul Isha was going off. Anyone who wants to look more into his life, Ibn al-Qayyim, he can read it in the kitab of Al-Wafi bil-Wafayat, Al-Mu'jab al-Mukhtas, A'yan al-Asr, Al-Bidayi wal-Nihaya, Dailu Tabaqati al-Hanabila, Al-Radd al-Wafir, Al-Durar al-Kamina, Bughyat al-Wu'at, and also none other than the book I told you all before, written by Al-Sheikh Bakr ibn Abdullah Abu Zayd, rahimahullah. He has the best book written in the life of Ibn al-Qayyim, which he called it Ibn al-Qayyim Hayatuhu Hayatuhu Atharuhu wa Mawaridu. Anything which I have said that was wrong, incorrect, mistake, fault, error, is from me as shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.